Good morning friends, I'm Srishti and today we are going to do another set of 5 questions of finance. I hope that you are liking this 5 question series, and if you like the videos then do subscribe to our channel for more regular updates and beneficial videos. Do not forget to hit the bell icon. Now, starting with the first question for today. Okay, so this question relates to the growth cut which has been done by World Bank recently. So the question says, World Bank in its analysis has observed that the remarkable weakness of Indian economic activity during the first half of 2019 is largely driven by external and cyclical factors. What is the growth projection made by World Bank for India for financial year 20? So let's first see the answer and then we'll see the growth projections done by other organizations in the next slide. So the answer is A, that is 6% from 7.5%, because it has earlier projected the growth of 7.5%, but now it has reduced it to directly 6%. Now let's move on to the next slide to see what are the growth projections done by other organizations. Okay, so Moody's, OECD, World Bank, RBI, India Ratings, S&P and ADB. These were the earlier projections that they did, and the new projection, that is after the slowdown for FY20, these are the projections. And these are important, so you may note these for your examination. So this was a kind of factual question that we did. Now moving on to the next question for today. Which of the following liquid ratios only considers cash and the marketable securities to test the short-term liquidity? So 4 options have been given to you and you have to tell me that which of the following ratios only consider the cash and the marketable securities. So discussing these ratios one by one in the next slide. Firstly, let us discuss that what liquidity ratio means. So it is a ratio which tells one's ability to pay off its debt as and when they become due. So firstly, let us discuss the current ratio. This ratio measures the financial strength of the company, and generally 2:1 ratio is treated as the ideal ratio. But although it depends upon industry to industry. So what is the formula? You all must be knowing it. Current assets upon current liabilities. Now to have a quick view on what current assets and current liability is. Current assets is stock, debtor, cash and bank, that is, which can be encashed into the liquid cash form within 12 months. And what are current liabilities? They are the amounts due to be paid to creditors within 12 months. So they include creditors or the short-term loan, banks, overdrafts, etc. Now moving on to the asset test ratio, it is also known as quick ratio. So this ratio is more conservative than the current ratio because the quick asset is computed by adjusting the current assets to eliminate those assets which are not in cash. And generally 1:1 is the ideal ratio for this. Now what is the formula? It is quick assets upon current liabilities. And what are quick assets? As I have already told you that they are computed by adjusting the current assets. So quick assets are current assets minus inventory minus prepaid expense. Now moving on to the absolute liquidity ratio. So this ratio measures the total liquidity available to the company. And it only considers the marketable securities and cash available to the company. So this ratio only tests the short-term liquidity in terms of cash, marketable securities and current investment. So by now you must have deduced the answer of the question that I have asked. Now the last one is basic defense ratio. I think that some of you doesn't know the meaning of basic defense ratio. So let's learn something new today. So this ratio measures the number of days a company can cover its cash expenses without the help of additional financing from other sources. So see, if there is a company, it has some cash expenses. So number of days it can cover those expenses without the financial sources from outside. So that basically means that with its own cash, with its own assets, how much days can it survive by paying the cash expenses? So what will be its formula? This is cash plus receivables plus marketable securities divided by operating expense plus tax plus interest. And as we know that this ratio is in terms of days, so we divide this by 365 to have the answer in number of days. Now moving back to the question, so you have to tell me the ratio that considers only cash and marketable securities to test the short-term liquidity. So our answer is absolute liquidity ratio. Now moving on to the next question for today, which among the following securities are not traded on negotiated dealing system for outright and repo transactions? So before answering the question, you must know what NDS is, that is negotiated dealing system. So we'll have a brief discussion about this term in the next slide. So pay attention. This system of negotiated dealing system was introduced in February 2002 to help the Reserve Bank of India enhance the dealings of its fixed income investments. Now prior to NDS, what happened was the country's government securities market was primarily telephone based, which meant that the buyers and sellers had to place trades over the phone, submit the physical subsidiary general ledger transfer forms, and issue checks for the settlement of funds to RBI. So these slow and inefficient procedures led to development and implementation of NDS. So it is the RBI operated electronic trading system that does away with the physical exchange of firms that I've already told you between its trading members in facilitation of exchanges of government securities and other money market instruments. Now NDS provides an interface to the security settlement system. All the outright and repo transactions in T-bills or the government dated securities, that is central and state government, are settled through NDS. Corporate bonds are not traded on NDS. Now another concept is of NDS OM. Now what OM is? This is order matching. So the problem largely with NDS was that it was not user friendly. So the working group on screen based trading in government securities, notice it was chaired by R.H. Patil, suggested the improvised NDS OM system, which did away with the inherent drawbacks of NDS. And also keep in mind that R.H. Patil was the person who was involved in the establishment of NSE, the National Stock Exchange. So this system is purely order driven, with all the orders being matched based on strict price or the time priority. Now moving back to the question to answer it after having this discussion and hoping that you know the answer now. So the security which is not traded on NDS is corporate bonds, that is option B, because T-bills and the government securities, be it the state government or the central governments, are traded on NDS. Corporate bonds is not traded. Now moving on to the next question for today. So this question is really interesting because the facts that we are going to discuss is really interesting. So do pay the attention here. The question is that which among the following is not true about the systematically core investment companies. So four statements have been given to you and you have to tell me the incorrect one. First is it has an asset size of 100 crores or more. Second is it holds not less than 90% of its net assets in the form of investment in equity shares, preference shares, bonds, debentures, debt or loans in group companies. Third is it can trade in investment in shares, bonds, debentures, debt or loans in group companies except through block sale for the purpose of dilution or disinvestment. And the fourth one is that it accepts the public funds. Now let's have a quick discussion on this topic as well and see that what is interesting about it in the next slide. Now over the last some years, RBI has carved out some specialized NBFCs like core investment companies, NBFC infrastructure finance companies, also known as IFC, infrastructure debt fund NBFCs or NBFCs, MFIs. So these are some specialized NBFCs, and one such type is of core investment companies that we are discussing right now. So do you remember that in the last statement we said that this systematically important core investment company can accept the public funds? So one question that generally comes in our mind is That is public funds same as public deposits? So the answer is no, public funds are not the same as public deposits. Public funds include public deposits, intercorporate deposits, bank finance, all the funds received whether directly or indirectly from the outside sources, such as funds raised by issue of commercial papers or debentures. However, even though the public funds include public deposits, in the general course, it may be noted that core investment companies that we are discussing right now cannot accept the public deposits. So isn't it interesting that the eligibility criteria of core investment companies is that it accepts public funds. Public funds include public deposits, but it has been specifically mentioned that core investment companies cannot accept one of the type of public funds. Now, CICs having asset size of below 100 crore are exempted from registration and regulation from the RBI. But if they have to make the overseas investments, then they have to get themselves registered. And the other thing that I want to discuss is that it cannot trade in its investments, its shares, bonds, debentures, debt or loans in group companies except through block sale for the purpose of dilution or disinvestment. So these are the eligibility criteria which have been mentioned on the RBI side. So now let's move back to the question to see the answer. So it has an asset size of 100 crores or more. This is true because it is one of the eligibility criteria of systematically important core investment company. Then it holds not less than 90% of its net assets in the form of investment. This is also true. It can trade in investments. So this is not true because it cannot trade in the investments in shares, bonds, debentures, debt or loans in group companies. So this is mentioned in the eligibility criteria. And the last one is it accepts the public funds. This is also true because this is one of the eligibility criteria. So our answer here is option C. Now moving on to the last question for today. The question is, which of the following options can be exercised at any time on or before its expiration date? So these are the types of options. So let's discuss it one by one. Now, if you own a European style option, then you have the right to buy or sell the underlying asset on which the contract is based only on the expiration date and not before. Whereas if you own American style contract, then you can exercise it on or before the expiration date. So our answer is option B, that is American option. Let's further discuss what naked option and covered options are. Now here in the naked option, the option seller or the writer does not hold the underlying assets and usually they are preferred by speculators. This also implies that the writers of naked options are unprotected, unlimited loss. Now we have the covered option. Covered options are the one where the option seller holds the underlying asset and it is usually preferred by hedgers, traders looking to reduce the cost. So with this, we have completed 5 questions of finance for today. I hope that you liked the video. Do subscribe to our channel for more regular updates. Hit the bell icon. Thank you for watching the video.